I think I've got an urge to lower the tone. Yes. So I am going to lower the tone. And just start with a very little story. Earlier this week on Tuesday, I was running something in the university in the drama department called a Taster Day. And the university runs days for young people in year 12 who are in schools that have a very low percentage of students going on into higher ed. They invite students who've got the ability but not necessarily the aspiration of going on to higher ed to come into the university, see what's it like to be a university student for the day. So I was saying a little bit about it. We had a whole day with them and I had some fantastic students of mine helping me run the day. And I started off with clapping. One of the introductory exercises, a clapping rhythm, that football one. Recognise that? Anyway, they're divided into three groups and you can do it as a round. So they'd started one group, started the next one comes in. So then they take the last two syllables and choose a word, a two-syllable word or phrase that they can say, which obviously is meant to be Chelsea or Arsenal or something like that. But anyway, they divided it up and they've got free reign to choose what they wanted to say. So one group had got pancake at the end, which I heard. Another group had got squirrel, which didn't work quite as well, and the other group were giggling and didn't really say anything. These were students, they were from co-educational schools, they didn't really know each other, so there's a whole lot of, who are you, who am I in this situation? Anyway, then they get together in these, stay in these groups, and the words go around, so you should be able to hear pancakes, we're all, da-da, whatever this third one was. And then they'll mingle around the room, so it's a good metaphor for how you keep your own. You listen to your own rhythm and your own words, but also you're listening to what other people are saying, trying to keep your own, maybe your own story, actually, intact. Anyway, we couldn't really hear this third group. So at the end, I said to them, you know, what did you hear? They'd all heard squirrels and pancakes. So I said to the third group, so what was your word? And I went, boobies. Boobies. And they couldn't really, they had a laugh about it, but they couldn't, in the event, follow through their intention. And I thought I just would mention it, because that's the thing that I've been listening to, all these really interesting, inspiring things people have been saying, and actually it's not the idea that is the powerful thing, it's the intention behind the idea, and that people have decided something and then really gone for it. So in that moment, you know, where I'm just sort of stranded with all these people and I've just got them to say boobies in front of everybody, it was a great gift actually to just say, yes, you know, that's fine, you can say boobies, I don't mind if you say boobies, but if you're going to say it, really say it. And if you don't want to say it, then choose another word, something that you can really put your intention behind. There's the lowered tone, and now I've got to put my intention behind what I meant to say, which is I want to say a bit about a couple of stories about what's got me to where I am now and why I do what I do, which is I work in a university, but I also run projects with young people in care, mainly, and other troubled young people. About 3 years ago, my dad died, and he died very suddenly. He was 75, and he was very well, and he went on a walking holiday in Nepal and had a heart attack and died immediately. So that was very shocking. My stepmother was there. So over the next, well, it's taken a few years, because it's when something sudden like that happens, it takes a lot to process it, I think. And my dad, I was very close to my dad. My dad and my stepmom lived very near me in Devon. And it's taken my stepmom a long time, but a couple of months ago she thought, right, I am going to move now, I'm ready. So I've been helping her move house. And she's kept everything. You know, she still had my dad's ties and socks in a drawer by her bed. So she's gone through a process of coming to terms with it, and in this process she found a pile of letters that my dad had kept. I didn't really know he was a hoarder, because he was also quite tidy, so all his hoarding was contained. But anyway, she gave me these letters, she didn't want them, and they were all the letters that
I'd written my dad, and my dad and mum split up when I was 8 and I went to a boarding school, so there's ample opportunity to write letters. So the letters started off with this very curly, darling daddy stuff, and then move on to when I was in India and Bangladesh travelling, where I'm giving a sort of socio-political account to try and educate him. And anyway, there are all these letters, and I found a letter that I'd written him when I was 14, and I'd been involved in rule breaking at school, and I was gated, which 30 years ago in a boarding school, being gated was a really terrible punishment, because it meant you couldn't go on any of the school trips. I was gated for 6 weeks, so I couldn't go out to the Wimbledon trip that everyone was going on. I couldn't even go into the little village. I couldn't go on bike rides. So I was felt imprisoned. And also, during that time, it was my grandmother's 75th, probably, birthday, so our whole family were coming together to have a celebration, and I couldn't go. So this letter was full of shame and remorse, and I'm so sorry. You know, I felt like I'd let down everybody in my family, and it was horrible. I can remember the feeling of writing this letter. But interestingly, there was also a letter, which I don't remember this, but I must have given back to my dad to keep. There's also the letter that he wrote in reply. And I read this letter, and he was an army officer, so part of what he was saying was, you know, take it on the chin, you've done this, you know, accept it. But the tone of the letter was so unjudgmental and accepting, and he wasn't blaming me at all. It was a very loving letter. And this phrase he wrote, those of us who break the rules must be prepared to accept the consequences. And that was really all he said. So anyway, that I think that just has reminded me very recently of a very real way that he showed his love for me. Anyway, I carried on in that school, and by the time I was 17, I was there doing A-levels, and I was a pretty angry and distressed teenager for reasons that I didn't really understand then, but in later years have made sense to me. But basically, I was troubled. My behaviour was pretty bad, and I felt pretty bad about myself. And in this troubled state one day, it seemed to me that the best thing I could do would be just to leave, to walk out, to not tell anybody, to run away, basically. You know, in the spirit of, you know, having an idea and following it through, I shoved a pillow down my bed and climbed out of the window and went out onto the street in the middle of the night to hitch a lift to London to, I don't know, be bad or face bad things or whatever it was that would be some outward expression of what I was feeling like internally. And I stood there waiting for some car to pick me up and take me to a train station in the middle of the night. I don't know what I was really thinking would happen. And I realised that I couldn't do it. And I couldn't do it not because I was afraid, really. I think it was because I couldn't do it to my dad. I just thought, if he finds out that I've left and nobody knows where I am, partly he'll be really terrified and worried, but also he'll blame himself. He'll think he's done something wrong, that he hasn't been a good dad, that he should have done something differently, and it'll kill him. I just thought, I can't make my dad think that he's a problem. So I went back to school and carried on. But there were two important things happened in that moment. One was that my dad's love actually literally kept me safe. And the other thing was I realised I'd got a choice, and somehow that changed everything. And the third thing was that I only realise now on reflection, is that it was a point where I started to tell a different story about myself. This is where we come back to stories, and I think that I now know that's what I was doing at that point. I was taking some sort of authorship of my life, starting to tell a story that worked for me positively rather than destructively. And I think now, with the drama projects that I create and the young people that I work with, I think that's at the root of it. I want to create a space for those young people to take authorship of their lives in a different way, or to start to find a way of telling their story about themselves a bit differently. And I thought, I'll give you an example, a project that I was doing just a few weeks ago. There was a young woman, called her Kelly, and she's 16. She's been in and out of care all her life. She now lives in a home with a carer, not a foster carer, she lives in residential care. And I hadn't met her, but she wanted to come on this three-day intensive drama project. And I know that if you've been removed from your birth family, that doesn't happen without neglect or abuse. So there's going to be experiences that aren't just stories, they're felt lived experiences of what that is, which she'll carry into all the situations she's in. And also, I know that that experience that I had of being kept safe by being loved is unlikely to be something that she has. So, and I can't give her that. None of us can go back to that time and make her into a loved, cared for child. But I think what can happen through, it doesn't have to be drama, but drama can provide appropriate space in which other experiences can happen that can validate and validate you, make you feel differently about yourself, make you feel held or cared for. Her carer said to me, I rang her up and said, is there anything, any kind of behaviour that I need to know about before this project starts? And she said, no, so Kelly's fine, but you know, she'll walk with her feet, vote with her feet. So if she doesn't like what's going on, she'll just leave, so that's fine, that's all I need to worry about. And she did arrive when we started, it's during that really hot week that we just had, seems a long time ago, and the windows were open, so her entrance was through the window, and we were all sitting there, and there was one comfortable chair, which she immediately took, so she made herself very comfortable, we were all on hard chairs, and she pulled out her phone, and she began by texting, and within 10 minutes she needed a fag break, and that's really fine, actually, because she, her experience of belonging to something is really difficult, painful, and has been disrupted. So she's been moved literally countless times. So every time she's joined a group and formed a group, either she's been moved from it without having any say or decision, part in the decision process, or she's walked with her feet, she's left before she could be ejected. So she's been removed from, you know, expelled from loads of schools because, I guess, making the choice and leaving is more comfortable than somebody else rejecting you. So it was fine for her to carry on using her phone, and we continued to do this drama process and create work together. And by the second day, she texted far less and she had far fewer cigarette breaks. And then on the third day, I was doing a project with a mixture of my students, drama students in the university, and these young people. So at 10 o'clock on a Friday morning, all my drama students are there, raring to go, and none of the young people were there on the third day of this performance project. And that is to be expected. I forget every time, but it is to be expected because their experience of endings is really difficult as well. So the journey they had to make to get there on the third day was difficult, very difficult for them. So we waited and I texted and rang, and eventually they all did arrive, but by then my students were, they understood that this is going to be a problematic process for them to go through. So we had lots of, chocolate and praise and created the piece of theatre and all went well. But at the very end of it, Kelly was sitting there. She still was in the comfy chair. She kept the comfy chair the whole time. But she sat there and she said, do you know what? I've never completed anything in my whole life. This is the longest. It's the only thing I've ever stuck at. And it was 3 days. It was the first thing she'd ever completed and chosen to stay at. And I don't know whether she understood, and maybe it's only on reflection one day that she'll get to see that that possibly was a point in her life where she began to change a story that she was telling about herself. And I've got 13 seconds, and it just reminds me of the thing Pip was saying right at the start of this session about, you know, you are the storyteller of your own life. And I think that's why I want to do those kinds of projects, to give people a chance to consciously be the authors of the story they're telling about their own lives.